It was just weird because my thoughts were, you gotta get knocked out or you gotta get absolutely crushed. And instead, I just got hit from behind, kind of like whiplashed my head. Wasn't even really head contact.
It was just random hits during the course of a game. You don't even think much of it, but wasn't feeling like myself afterwards, and I had to speak with the medical staff and realize that it was probably a concussion.
A concussion is a type of brain injury that occurs when the brain inside of the skull, it moves quickly or stops quickly when it's moving.
Process of moving back and forth causes disruption in the brain and causes difficulties in terms of how the brain functions.
Not all big hits cause concussions, and not all concussions come from big hits.
It can happen with a blow to the body, it can happen with a blow to the head, it could happen when your head makes contact with the shielding or with the ice.
I got hit in the neutral zone, and I remember getting back to the room, and I told the trainers, I think I'm pretty sure the knee and the groin is what we're gonna have to focus on. They're like, well, how's your head?
Signs and symptoms of possible concussion.
Concussion can produce visible signs, that is, behaviors which are noticeable by other people. A visible sign might be something like balance or coordination impairment following a hit. A symptom is something that the player feels. It's something they report, for example, a headache. So you can't see if the player has a headache, but you can see if a player has a balance or coordination impairment.
With some concussions, there are observable signs that are objective, and that's why we have spotters watching the game.
The spotters for us provide a great advantage to giving us reassurance that there's always somebody in the background keeping an eye on things on the ice that potentially could be happening in a situation or an area of the ice that we can't see directly or potentially haven't been able to notice something happen on the ice.
I think individuals can definitely appreciate the spotters. I think that there's a need for it, for sure. In hindsight, you have to respect them because they're just trying to help you.
I think there's been a process that has evolved which now allows everybody to say, something's happened here and we need to slow down for a second.
I think the protocol is excellent. It gives us things to be aware of as we enter the game. And it also gives the trainers the ability to say, okay, I've seen this, I need to get you out.
But not all concussions have observable signs, and that's why players reporting their symptoms is so important in the detection of the injury.
Generally, we can think of the symptoms of concussion as falling into four broad categories. Somatic symptoms such as headache, dizziness, or nausea, for example. Emotional or behavioral or psychological symptoms such as anxiety or depressive symptoms. Cognitive symptoms such as people saying they feel foggy or can't remember things. And perhaps even sleep disturbance.
I need the players to be honest and tell me how they're feeling. Do they have a headache? Do they have any dizziness? Are the lights bothering them? Is the sound bothering them? Do they feel nauseous? Any of those symptoms we need to know. And we need to take care of it.
Coaches, teammates, and management view head injuries as a very serious issue, and we need players to be honest with us and tell us when they're having symptoms to come out of the game. It's not a reflection of anything except you have an injury.
The symptoms of concussion can also be seen in other conditions. For example, dehydration may give you lightheadedness or difficulty with thinking. Insomnia may lead to difficulties with concentration and thinking process, and yet none of these are concussion, but they do share features with concussion. So it's important to bring the symptoms to the attention of the team physician, team athletic trainer, so that they can make a proper diagnosis. Symptoms can vary from one player to the next. Not only that, they may vary in the same person from one concussion to the next.
One of the things that we know about concussions is that early symptom reporting and early intervention is critical. So having players report their symptoms as soon as they identify those symptoms or as soon as a teammate identifies those symptoms is really important, because the sooner we identify those symptoms, the sooner that we can intervene and the better the recovery process and less time loss.
I think it was more the eyes thing, couldn't focus on thing, couldn't stay focused or track the puck, track things, right? And I thought that was the biggest one there.
And I just remember that day feeling just really out of it. Like, I just wasn't feeling good. was really unaware of what I was feeling. I had never gone through a concussion and just didn't feel like myself at all. Just thought I was having a bad day.
Players don't always recognize that they have a concussion because the very nature of the injury itself, which is a type of brain injury, can cause impairment to one's awareness. And for that reason, we have to not only rely on subjective reporting that the player identifies, but also assistance provided by others, such as team trainers, coaches, or teammates.
I think guys now take such pride in their teammates that they'll do the work to make sure that their buddy's gonna be okay. I think that the culture in hockey, guys are so close, they don't wanna see anything bad happen to each other. Guys are genuine with each other to make sure that their health is dealt with.
On the bench, players and also coaches are very important because what they might see, if they're giving a player an instruction and they're just not doing what they usually would do on the ice, that's important feedback for us.
Evaluation for possible concussion.
Right when I got off the bench, the team took me right down the tunnel, monitored me quickly. They did the right thing. They helped me out.
It's not easy to take yourself out of it, right? You think, just finish a period or finish a game, right? I'll be fine. But, you know, sometimes that second hit is the one that makes the most damage.
It's important to take the player to a distraction-free environment to evaluate them for a concussion. For the player's perspective, it takes them out of that competitive environment. They can kind of cool down. They're in a quiet area. They're able to attend to how they feel better. You know, do I feel normal? Sometimes the adrenaline of the game, the competitive nature of being right by ringside is difficult to kind of think about themselves.
Just because somebody leaves a game doesn't mean that they have a concussion. We just want to make sure that they're safe.
When the medical staff evaluate the player off the ice, they talk to the player, they do a physical exam, a neurologic evaluation, test balance, and also test the way the brain functions in terms of thinking with memory and concentration tasks.
I didn't feel a ton of symptoms right away, but the next day I was definitely thankful that they pulled me out of activity.
Concussions are a dynamic injury that tend to evolve, so the symptoms don't always show up early on. Some show up immediately, typically headaches, nausea, things like that, but others take longer to develop, so you may not notice it for 24 hours, you may not notice it for 48 hours, maybe on the bus ride or on the plane ride home. They also change over time, so symptoms that develop early may morph into other symptoms later on, which makes this a difficult injury to track.
Originally, there wasn't much to it. You know, it wasn't until the day after that I started really getting sensitive to light and noise and distractions, you know, everyday type of stuff that would just, you know, never bother me before. But all of a sudden, I couldn't even sit, you know, in the locker room without being bothered and by the noise and the music and the lights and everything. You know, that's really, the day after was really when I first started realizing that something wasn't right with my head.
Management of concussion.
The initial treatment involves a period of rest of about 24 to 48 hours, and then we get players gradually, more progressively active physically, mentally, as long as it doesn't make their symptoms worse. Once their concussion-related symptoms resolve, then they go through a structured return to activity program, building up to the intensity that they need to go back to playing hockey.
After that initial period of rest, we'll start them on low-level exercise. We usually put them on a bike for 15 to 20 minutes, low heart rate, low intensity. If they have no problems with that, then we increase on a daily basis the time and the intensity.
There have been great advancements in the area of treatment. Often a concussion is accompanied by a neck injury or a balance problem or a visual disturbance. So doing therapy for the neck, doing vision training skill exercises, doing vestibular rehabilitation can be very effective, especially if instituted early in the recovery process.
My physical rehab was a combination of on-ice and off-ice exercises, a lot of vestibular activities to kind of reintroduce certain high-speed exercises, a lot of eye movements to dial that back in. We just did a good job with it. We were very diligent with it, and sure enough, things started to turn the corner.
Essentially, the players need to feel normal at rest, feel normal with physical activity, and then be back at their baseline functioning from a cognitive and neurological perspective, and then we feel they're safe to go back into hockey activity.
Psychological symptoms of concussion.
The actual concussive injury can trigger the symptoms of psychological disturbance, and or it could be indirectly caused by being away from the team for a longer period of time.
I did feel some emotional symptoms with my concussions, especially with the first one. I think it was more later on during the process, which I was getting a little depressed in a way where fatigued all the time and just not wanting to get up in the morning.
The behavioral symptoms with a concussion are fairly common, and they can include irritability, anxiety, and depression.
When your head is constantly hurting or eyes are hurting or any other symptoms, you know, your fuse is real short. And I don't think I found any ways to deal with it until I really started opening up to my family and my friends and really letting them know that this is tough.
It's a frustrating injury too, because even though you get diagnosed, you never know how long it's going to be, right? And you always wonder if it's normal, if you're game better or... then you know, you see teammates go and practice and play, and you want to be back with them, and everybody's asking, you know, how you doing, you're coming back soon, right, when you're back, and the fans and stuff, right? So it's in your head a lot. That's all you think about, right, trying to get back in it and trying to feel normal again.
The important thing is to be able to identify those symptoms early, to communicate with your medical staff if you're experiencing those symptoms, because we know that if we intervene with those symptoms early, then the individual will have a much quicker recovery with far fewer complications.
I think having them around the rink, around their teammates, being involved as much as they can, that helps keep them positive.
It felt really good to talk about it and to realize that I'm not alone in this, and it went a long way for sure. It helped me a lot.
Recovery from concussion.
It is often said that concussion is an injury of individual differences. So no two injuries are alike, and therefore no two recovery trajectories are alike as well.
The biggest thing I've done, I think, is making sure I took the time to really listen to my body, and when I was ready, I was ready.
On average, the length of recovery time from concussion is generally about 1 to 2 weeks in our experience.
Recovery from concussion varies from player to player. It can even vary in the same player across two concussions.
There's not like one recipe for every concussion, right, to get better.
Potential long-term consequences. There is a great deal of individual variability in determining how many concussions are too many for a player. This question is best answered by having a comprehensive evaluation done by a medical team who can review your entire history and current functioning. While most players recover quickly, others may experience prolonged symptoms. Players and medical staff need to be attentive to the potential for long-term problems such as cognitive impairment or psychological symptoms. A different focus of scientific and media interest has been on the condition known as chronic traumatic encephalopathy, or CTE. This is an abnormality that has been identified in some individuals after death upon autopsy. Some researchers have suggested that repetitive head impacts or concussions cause CTE. Other researchers and international bodies suggest that research has not proven if head impacts or concussions cause CTE. However, clinicians and players must be mindful of the potential for developing CTE. The science continues to evolve, and further study is needed. The key is to become educated. Talk with trusted medical experts about CTE and other possible long-term consequences of head injuries.
My biggest advice that I was told during that time was to be positive, but be patient and realize that things will get better, even though when you're in it, it's tough and you want to get back out there as an athlete, but it's for the future, it's for your career, but it's also for the rest of your life.
It's not a bruise, it's not a broken finger. It's a lot more serious than that. It's your brain.
The most important thing I think we have are the assets and the players on the ice. We've got to take care of them.
At the end of the day, you have to do what's best for you. Everyone wants to play this game for a long, long time, but aside from that, many of us have aspirations to you know, have long, long, happy lives with families and children and all that. And in order to do that, you need to have a full functioning brain in order to live the life that you want.
As a goalie, I think it's important to be honest, you know, for yourself, for your health, and for your teammate also. Our margin of error is very slim, right? Because then pucks are going in and you're losing games, right? So I think you gotta, again, be honest and do the best thing for you, but also for your teammates.
You gotta be able to step back and look at the big picture. I mean, it's your health, it's your body, it's your mind, and it's ultimately your life, and that has to be priority.